Hello everybody, George here with Islamophobia Watch. As you know, my focus with this channel is on Islam, exposing Islam for what it is, and also exposing the entire Islamophobia propaganda for what it is. There is very little on the internet that reveals, improves, and makes the keys for the hoax that the Islamophobia propaganda or the anti-Islamophobia propaganda is all about. And so it is my hope that in the next a year or so, we will create a good, strong library presenting a strong case for proving that the Islamophobia propaganda that's been going on in the last 30 years in the free world is what it is. It's propaganda, and it's false, and it's a tool of global jihad to shut us up, to destroy free speech, and to secure cover for the global jihad's agenda. Now, this is great, and we can make steps towards achieving this goal. The first step has been made. Up until a year ago, if you were just an unsuspecting person and you're like, well, let me find out, you know, are there any watch groups that are watching this whole Islamophobia thing? And you typed up Islamophobia Watch, all you would get would be pro-jihadist organization, leftist, Marxist, and pro-jihadist organizations such as CARE and others, who are putting out propaganda. And this propaganda, it was uncontested, basically. In other words, if you're an unsuspecting person, and that is the audience, that's the profile of the audience that I am thinking about when I create content, I really don't care what the jihadists have to say. We already know what they have to say. I don't care to preach to the choir. I worry about the fact that there are sincerely honest people out there who sincerely want to know what's up with this Islamophobia thing. Is this for real? Right? And these are the people I'm creating content for. I want them to have a choice. I want them to have the ability to make up their own mind. Let them go to the propaganda websites. Let them see what they have to say. But let them also have the opportunity to hear what we have to say, we being people whose eyes have been opened, we being the people who have a whole lot of evidence to show what global jihad is, how it operates in the West, and how it's achieving its goals to destroy free speech, which is essential to any free society, right? We're not asking for special protection. We're not asking for anything else except equal playing field. Of course, our opponents are not like that. They'll shut us up and shut us down. As soon as they get an opportunity to do that, they will use the powers of government to come after us. They're not honest. They don't have dignity. They are dishonest, shameless, pathological liars, and actually, in many cases, well-trained jihadi operatives who would chop our heads off, let alone shut down our websites or social media accounts. Are you kidding me? I mean, people need to understand the nature of the enemy we're dealing with. The left would have never achieved their goals in Soviet Russia if it wasn't for violence. And Islam would have never achieved its goals. It would have never survived as an ideology or religious cult if it wasn't for the violence, the terrorism, the sword. That's it. This is what has actually secured and proliferated the existence of both Islam and communism. It's the power of violence. Violence, that's it. There's no power of argument. It's the argument of power. That's how these people operate. Now, we, being free-thinking people, being people who honor and respect human beings, who want a peaceful society, who want, you know, an honest battle of ideas, we're different. We're laying out our arguments. We are expecting to have intelligent opponents who will bring up their arguments and may the best guy win, right? But that's not how they are. So you have to understand the nature of the conflict. And here's what I want to highlight with this podcast is specifically the issue of censorship. Because now, even though I may be creating content, and a year later, if someone says, let me see what's going on, is there watch groups that are watching Islamophobia? And if an honest, sincere person types in the internet Islamophobia watch groups or Islamophobia watch or whatever else, something similar to that, what they'll get is they'll get some of the top websites, CARE, for example. They'll get Wikipedia, and they'll get my website. So now, this person who wants to know, you know, what watch groups there are out there who are watching the whole Islamophobia problem, he ends up on my website and he realizes quickly we are critical of Islam, or we're critical of Islamophobia as a propaganda tool, and we're exposing it for what it is. So there are people out there who have yet to make up their own mind, right? And that's where the battle is. The battle is for the people who have yet to make up their own mind, because the reality and the truth is that we still have a lot of clueless people. That's true. I mean, just because some of you guys who are following my website and, you know, we're all on the same page, we're a minority, actually. The majority of people are still clueless. Now, the political candidates of various parties may refer to them as the moderate middle or whatever, but they're just basically clueless people who are busy living their lives. The goal of their life is not to study Islam. What kind of a crazy thing that is? People got lives to worry about. And that's the nature, actually, of free people. They shouldn't be preoccupied with politics. They shouldn't be preoccupied with terrorist activities and who chopped how many heads and all that crazy, disgusting stuff. The reason we're doing this is because we're under assault. And the reason we're doing this also because the media is completely useless. Supposed to be the watchdog in a free society, and they're supposed to perform investigations, and they're supposed to highlight the activities of shady, terroristic characters in our midst and bring attention to their activities. And so, and then we're supposed to have the government clean house, right? We're supposed to have the government take care of these problems. But all that is absolutely rendered meaningless. It's not functional. We don't have media that will perform due diligence on the individuals running mosques or due diligence on CARE. They're not going to report or any of these people and what they do, honestly. And we have no authorities now who will prosecute, who will investigate and prosecute with the power of the state, which, by the way, is the sole thing that the state exists for. It exists for it to protect us. Right? Taxpayers, people who actually pay their dues into this whole system, right? They're supposed to protect us, both internally, as far as the police and other institutions, and externally, in terms of the armed forces. The one thing that the state has been tasked with in a free society, they're failing to perform. And that means that it's us. We have to perform the investigations. We, the people, have to look into allegations of terroristic activity, for example, or what Islam is. That's what we're doing. That's why I'm doing what I'm doing right now. It's our duty, and it's also self-preservation. So there is an element of selfishness, if you want to call it that. I call it an instinct, survival instinct. I'm basically doing what I'm doing because I want my family and friends to know what's going on, first of all, because those are the people I have some responsibility for. I don't have responsibility to save the rest of the world, right? Neither do you. So the first people you need to worry about is your own family and educate them. And if you can't, if your family is closed-minded and they don't want to hear, so then educate your friends, you know, people that you trust. And then once we do that, we have a whole lot of other people that we really have no obligation to, except we have an obligation to liberty itself and God himself. We educate society. We educate the community. And so that's what this is about. The problem is now censorship in terms of purging the internet. There's actually a massive effort to purge the internet itself. And destroy websites and pages and references and videos And that is the issue that we need to look at. Why should I be putting up websites? Why should I be doing what I'm doing if I'm going to publish something and it's going to be censored, right? And why should I be, you know, putting the hard work into putting up a website that my hosting service will just take down, and then somebody else will take down? And so we need to resolve some technical issues here, and those issues will be resolved through the blockchain, because the blockchain basically presents an entire new technology to serve information, and it's a lot more secure than the centralized web, number one. Number two, it's very difficult, next to impossible, as far as censorship. But this also means that search will be very different, right? Search will be very different because the search engines are pretty much adapted to the old structuring of websites and protocols that how content is being indexed and served and so forth and so on. So basically, we are on the verge of developing an entire new parallel economy, an entire new parallel information highway, and it will be very relational. You are going forward in the future, you're going to want to know who are the people that you're getting your information from, and you're going to have probably a friend pass on to you the URL, because you won't be able to find it on Google. Google will become meaningless. It will only be useful for if you're buying something from a store or stuff like that, utilitarian usage that excludes anything that has to do with politics or philosophy or history or anything like that. And so search is going to be very different. I don't know how search will function in a blockchain-based internet, because it's very different. Content is indexed very differently. It's distributed very differently. It's very difficult to track as it is. It uses hashes and things like that. And so we are basically on the verge of a major, major technological change that few people grasp and understand. And yours truly is involved in that. I'm trying to put together a technology stack that would allow the little man, the little guy, the little activist, the one guy who has a voice and has something to say, or the group of people or activist organization that doesn't want to rely on Google and all kinds of censorship organizations. How can we equip them to get up on the internet and not be censored, not to have somebody come and shut down their domain name or shut down their access or hosting, things like that? And how do I know that once I put up content, it's going to be there and it's not going to disappear, right? These are the big issues that we're looking at. It's taking some time, because I really feel like, you know, why create content and put it up there when it's just going to be shut down or censored or something like that. All right, thanks for listening. I hope that you visit our website. I'm using the blog more and more to put up content, and I'm looking forward to the next episode in this epic battle for liberty.